Okay.
All right, let's go. So my name is Christy Santano and this is Melanie Thorley. So we are both solicitors here at MJT Law. So today we're really going to talk about social media and how it really interacts with employment and the workplace. When we're talking about social media, really what we're talking about is Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok. I'm happy to put my hand up and say I've got an account on all of those. I also have a Twitter account, a Reddit account. So it's kind of never ending. We know that about 3 weeks ago, Facebook announced that they are creating what is called a metaverse. If you've ever watched The Matrix, it's very, very similar. So you would put your virtual reality headsets on and you would essentially walk around a universe. You would go to, you know, events very similar to this. We could be presenting, you know, in 10 years' time to a virtual audience instead. So we know that our lives, if they haven't already, are completely intertwined with our personal lives, with our professional lives. When I was preparing for today, I decided to Google myself, and if you haven't already done it, I suggest you do. And to my surprise, the first two pages of Google were completely related to MJT Law. There is absolutely no ways you could not determine that I was not working here. If you knew my name, you knew where I worked.
Yeah.
And I suggest for most people, it's the exact same. So with this kind of intertwining, it means whether employers are prepared or not, they will need to really kind of delve into people's, you know, into a bit of a personal space, because it reflects on them as employers, and it can do in a damaging way. So what we want to teach you today is firstly what exposure an employer might have when it comes to social media, and then how do you get on the front foot, and once you've identified exposure, how can you get on the front foot and make sure that you've got the tools to really reduce your liability, to make sure that when things go wrong, you've covered all your bases. So why don't we kick it off with, so there's really our key points of exposure. So we've got workplace health and safety. Obviously we all, employers have a primary duty to keep all their employees safe, and that includes safe from mental impairment. So we've also got discrimination, harassment and bullying. So with all of these, we really thought we might give you some real examples, some cases which have happened in the past, which really highlight how this all happened. So first of all, I want to go through, so this case of Robinson and Lorna Jane. We all know Lorna Jane, and this case actually involved the DFO store just over on North Brisbane. It involved a manager. So she was a store manager, and she obviously had a area manager who overlooked her store. And pretty well from the outset, they had a pretty hostile and cold relationship. And nevertheless, she would be called things like, she was cheap. She was called a generator, which will make sense when they were both also Facebook friends. And her area manager posted, and I'm going to quote, "I've discovered a new name for the people I despise. I call them generators, purely because they fill their days generating more problems for me to deal with. Generators are similar to mutants, people who are genuine oxygen thieves." Now, she also posted, "What a day. It is difficult to soar with the eagles when you're surrounded by turkeys. Is it too late to pursue a different career?" So what happened with this case is she, the manager, she felt as though she had suffered a psychological injury as a result of these social media posts and the, I suppose, bullying she was receiving from her area manager. And so she filed a essentially a workplace health and safety injury or personal injury claim. She was unsuccessful, and the court really found that the posts themselves couldn't really be linked to her specifically, even though if you put two and two together, you think that's probably around her, but they really made the distinction that this particular area manager, when she was making these posts, could have really been about anyone in the entire organization. But that's really about the area manager itself. So what about the employer? The court found that they had really taken all reasonable steps to avoid the situation, because although it had happened and they had taken steps to get on the front foot, they had policies in place which meant that this type of behavior wasn't to be accepted, that it wasn't to be encouraged. What they also did was asked the area manager to immediately remove the posts. They also disciplined the area manager. They also removed her from the area that she was managing to a different area so that the two employees wouldn't come into contact. And really the court came to say that these were quite practical steps that had been taken, and there wasn't really much else that the employer could have done to avoid the harm and reduce it in that way. So when we're kind of thinking about the takeaways there is, what can the employer do to firstly make sure that all employees know that this type of behaviour isn't to be accepted in the first place? But if it does happen, what can we do to stop it? So that's really workplace health and safety, but I know that you have some case around discrimination.
I do have a case around discrimination. This is about a security guard who worked in the airport. Now, this is a really interesting case. It's a case in England where a person posted a gollywog on their Facebook page and said, let's see how far he can travel before Facebook takes him off. Come and sit down. And the image was shared.
What's the image, sorry?
The image was a gollywog.
Oh, okay.
So one of those, yeah. And the image was shared around, and the applicant themselves complained of harassment and said that, you know, they found that offensive. And the person who put it up, you know, apologised, took it down, and so on and so forth. But when we're thinking about how that works in a working environment or a working setting, what we've got is an employee who's popped what has been considered by somebody else an offensive image, popped an offensive caption on it, and then it's been shared at work. So when we're thinking about social media in the workplace, this is a really good example. And the court came up with a really interesting statement. The tribunal considered whether the respondent had taken all reasonable steps to prevent the employee from doing this discriminatory act. And its conclusion was the tribunal takes into account that the respondent has policies which make clear that the behaviour complained was unacceptable. They were also satisfied that in signing contractual documents, the respondent brings these policies to the attention of the employees. And in terms of publishing the policies and auditing and monitoring the policies, they've got no evidence of what steps they took, but they do have evidence that the respondent not only says it takes the matter seriously, but in this case did take it seriously and started disciplinary proceedings against the employee. Now, this case was unsuccessful in linking the employer to the act. But here in Australia, vicarious liability exists, and we'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. And we believe that the image would have been linked back to the employer, and the employer would have been vicariously liable for that image. And the result would have probably been the same anyway, because the employer took steps to mitigate that loss, to deal with it at the time, thereby reducing their liability. Because an employer, as employers, we know that there's only so much we can do. Can't stop people from doing stupid stuff, but we can deal with it when it's happening. And we're going to talk a little bit about how to deal with it when it's happening a bit further down this presentation. But this discrimination one's really interesting because this gollywog image was actually discriminatory. The images, even under Queensland anti-discrimination, would be considered discriminatory. So how does an employer stop this sort of thing from happening? And in this case, it was their policies and the application and implementation of the policies that help them reduce that mitigation of liability.
That's confirmed. So yeah. Is that from the through the employer's social account or the employees?
The employees. So
employee's private account.
Employee's private account posted this image. Someone from the workplace has found that image and it's been sent to them, and yeah, they've found that offensive and they've complained in the workplace of discrimination.
Right. So yeah, not the employer's social account?
No, we're not talking about situations where the employer is up to mischief. Yeah, we're talking about...
I'm saying with the employee to it, having access to the...
This is not about the employer's Facebook page.
Yeah, right, okay.
These are all personal Facebook pages.
Right, yeah.
And we talked a little bit earlier on about how these days, and certainly in recent times, people, individuals have been using their social media more often. I certainly know for the first time in years I've used Facebook more in the last 2 years than I have probably in the last decade. And if you have friends who are also work colleagues on your Facebook pages, then it's likely they're going to get access to that content as well. And this is what's creating the problems. So we're here today to talk about how to reduce and mitigate those issues. You've got another one.
Yeah. So
you've got one about harassment.
So I'm going to focus on sexual harassment in this particular example, but it should be said that harassment can be for a number of different reasons. But as we know, sexual harassment is a really topical and is quite a big issue at the moment. So this case involves a gentleman that he was at the pub one night. He probably had one too many, and when he got home, he had a sort of a Facebook messenger group, as a lot of us do, with 19 individuals. A number of them were colleagues, and for whatever reason, he decided he'd post quite a lot of pornography onto this page. Now, it should be said, none of the colleagues and none of the people in the Facebook group, or the Facebook messenger group, had any issue with it. They didn't have any, they weren't finding it offensive or anything like that. Now, this particular person was dismissed, and he was dismissed for sexual harassment. And the thing that the commission found was, despite the fact that it didn't actually commit harm, the test is really an objective one. So the test is, was it unwanted? Was it sexual of nature? And does it have, would it cause a reasonable person to feel offended, embarrassed, or harmful? And the dismissal was upheld, and the commissioner really had quite a lot of comments to say and quite a lot of compliments for the company, because they really got on the front foot and they had policies in place and they implemented despite the fact that it didn't cause harm. They knew that abundantly that behaviour was not to be accepted. It's quite clear you shouldn't really be sending pornography to your colleagues. But it doesn't matter that they didn't find it offensive, because that particular employee, when he sent those images, he couldn't have possibly have known that the people on the other side of that wouldn't have found that offensive in any way. And it's really important, I suppose, for employers to remind themselves that policies are only really as good as they are implemented. And implementation takes strength. It takes almost courage to put aside a number of some of the practical elements and really enforce them for what they are. So where there is abundantly clear, abhorrent behaviour, that it really be punished for or disciplined for.
Could you actually elaborate on what is discrimination? So if you two actually find something that's not offensive and five of us says that is offensive, who's right and who's wrong?
Okay, discrimination doesn't require a guilty mind. So to be discriminating, you don't require the feeling of being discriminating. Let me give you an example. I had a couple of years ago a woman call me and she says, I'm 5 months pregnant and my boss has told me that my boss came up to me and she said to me, look, I remember what it was like when I was pregnant and I was really tired all the time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to reduce your travel to zero and I'm going to reduce your job to make sure that you're not feeling really tired and we will get you through this pregnancy. Now, The boss thought she was doing something really nice, but in fact it was incredibly discriminating against this woman who was 5 months pregnant. So it doesn't require the person who's been discriminating to feel they've been discriminating. It doesn't require that that additional step.
What does it require?
I'm sorry?
What does it require then?
There is an objective element, but it's a lot of subjectiveness when it comes to discrimination. When we think about discrimination, we think about, first of all, the subjective element. Does the person feel discriminated against? And we know that we've recently got these new sexual harassment laws, and it's really about, does that person feel like what happened was sexual harassment? But then the objective element is not the objective element from the person who has discriminated, but objectively, would this be considered something that might be discriminating? Does that make sense?
It really comes to that kind of, and it happens all the time in law, this reasonable test. And what a reasonable test is I think it's when you really go back to old English lawyers.
The guy that sits on the number 11 bus in London.
So just your average person. What would your average person on the street think of it?
Yeah.
But you can fight that, can't you?
You can what, sorry?
Fight that.
What
do you mean?
You're saying this is you're discriminating, and the other person says, no, I'm not discriminating, I'm just actually taking care of you. That's discrimination, because you're actually pointing them to that discrimination point.
What about if you asked the pregnant lady, would that then be different? Or is it still...
Are you asking for a way to have that conversation without being discriminating at the same time?
If the pregnant lady is 5 months pregnant, like posing that question to them.
Well, going, I think there were. I think the language could have been polished at the time. The employer could have asked more questions to the employee what they wanted, because pregnant women aren't disabled. So they don't necessarily need to have their jobs reduced because they're pregnant. It doesn't make it a lot of sense anyway. I think probably the better conversation could have been that the employer wanted to know how to support that pregnant woman throughout the pregnancy until they took time, instead of putting their hand up and saying, this is what we're going to do.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I think employees are also in control of how they perform as well. And if it came down to a performance issue, there may have been better questions asked. But at the time, there was nothing... There was no performance issue.
Is the employee actually responsible for duty of care if the woman's pregnant?
Duty of care?
Yeah.
Well, an employer has a duty of care to all employees,
whether they're
pregnant or not.
Well, obviously, if someone's pregnant, obviously, they've actually had another...
You're talking about levels of duty of care?
Yeah.
An employer has the same level of duty of care to all its employees to make sure that they are in a safe and healthy working environment.
Okay, but in her circumstances, it's changing over a period of, 9 months.
The difficulty they would have had, if you kind of go down that sort of thought process, is how are they going to be the ones to determine how much risk she is at?
We're
just lay people. They could have gone to us as lawyers and we would have told them the same thing, which is we're not really qualified to give that type of assessment. How much risk is she actually at if she does X, Y, and Z? And neither is their employer.
If you're on a building site and stuff like that, and you says, you're pregnant, does the person actually just say, look, if you're on a building site, you're pregnant and stuff like that, we don't have, emergency, procedures for pregnant women on building sites, you know what I mean?
I suppose that comes down to, is she able to
do their job? Remember, we're talking about an employer-employee relationship. So if that employee is able to perform their duties in the same way...
But if the woman actually, breaks the water on top of that, obviously it's a, she's got to be rushed to the hospital. It's.
Okay, but are you saying woman...
She's just about to actually give birth.
So is your question, how do you mitigate potential medical emergencies in a situation where we can foresee something might be happening?
Well, if she's 9 months pregnant, that's right, not 5 months, not
right.
2 months.
I've never been pregnant, but it's my understanding that most females will stop work before they give birth to their babies.
What if she refuses to stop work?
I'm sorry?
What if she wanted to continue work while she's actually almost about
Well, again, the employer has a responsibility from a work health and safety perspective to keep...
Yeah, but what's his responsibility if she's about to actually give... I mean, people give birth in taxi cabs, and train stations and stuff like that, sort of thing. They don't stop,
Are you talking about a one-off situation where
No, one-off. You know, there's lots of people that actually have births in taxi cabs having delivery, going to the hospital.
I think perhaps applying a suitable should we test. What's going on here? Is this a safe and healthy working environment for the people involved?
Yeah.
And then having better conversations about it.
Well, what's the employee's responsibility if the woman wants to continue work up to the point of birth?
There is some help in relation to that in the Fair Work Act. You can ask your employee to attend a medical examination to make sure that they're capable of doing their work from moving forward. You're well within your rights to do that.
And generally they...
if they don't get clearance to work...
What is the baby comes out on the day that...
Okay, you're talking about a very narrow set of circumstances.
Oh, all you're doing is actually just covering a basis for the employee. To say, because I've been on job sites and stuff that we're in the middle of nowhere.
But when was the last job site you were on that someone actually gave birth?
No.
Right. So yeah. I'm not sure you're talking about a set of circumstances that sit in the real world. That's the problem here.
Yeah.
Well, you had a question, sorry?
I was just going to make a comment that it would come down to any employee that may potentially have an issue. They've sprained their ankle or they had a horse roll on them or something like that. You're going to be asking for... Here's the list of your duties, and you're required.
Can you perform them?
This. Can you get your doctor to confirm? Yes, you're still able to do that. And if not, what can you do, and what accommodations do we need to make?
Yes.
That's exactly right. All right. I think we can probably move on from that one to our last one about bullying.
Workplace bullying. Yes.
A very emerging.
It is a very emerging issue. I think. People are. We're getting a lot more workplace bullying complaints coming through our office. This is the one where three employees, a manager and two subordinates, each made an application for an order to stop bullying. Now, I need to let you know that this organisation had a lot of problems. There was, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, but the new chap that was involved in been the organisational effectiveness and change manager, which I'm going to assume in this case is a really long-winded term of calling someone HR, said that since starting my role at the terminal, I've been involved in management and employee concerns about inappropriate workplace conduct. Given my day-to-day involvement in these concerns, I observed high levels of distrust among the workforce at the terminal. And so this is an endemic problem, by the looks of it, in this particular organisation. And amongst other things, the employees were complaining of false rumours which were posted on Facebook about other employees. The posts were on particular employees' Facebook pages, but other employees and friends could see them. Specifically, posts alleged that the employee was receiving favourable rosters and therefore receiving a greater amount of overtime because they were sleeping with a manager. And the posts alleged that every employee knew of the relationship and an involved employee who was married. So this is not, this is stuff we hear, right? This is happening in this workplace. And the Commission found that the behaviour was unreasonable and repeated and therefore amounted to bullying. But when we think about the employer's relationship to this, the Commission found that the relevant bullying was not limited to a point in time and that the behaviour would continue so as long as the comments were remained on the social network. So when we're thinking about a successful bullying claim, what we're doing is we're asking the Commission to ask the employer to stop whatever's happening. So in this case, we've got some problems where there's just a broken relationship between the employer and employee in the workplace. And taking into account some of the things that were coming up, there was a very low level of trust There were instances where people have recorded conversations with other employees to prove what was being said at the time. He'd spoken to a number of employees about issues in the workplace and said that they don't want to get involved and they don't want to be named because they're reluctant to come forward as witnesses. So this is a situation where I think the employer has fundamentally failed to get control of this situation, and it really does turn to pot, doesn't it? And this bullying claim gets a bit out of control. And when we talk a little bit about how investigations are run, I'm gonna go back to this case because there's a lot of stuff going on that needed to be investigated that just was left out in the open.
Just kind of left there
running around.
Yeah.
So when we're talking about bullying and social media, what the commission concluded was if the post is up, then the bullying is continuing. So it may be one post, but if it's there, it's happening over and over and over again. And that's something we've really got to be mindful of. We know that bullying needs to happen more than once. And the argument is obviously, but it's only one post. But that's not enough. So we need to think about what's actually happening out there on that social media page, how it's affecting the employees, and as an employer, what are we actually doing to support that?
So we've been talking through our real key areas of exposure, and we've really been talking about what can the employers do to kind of mitigate their liability. So what we're really talking about here is vicarious liability.
So vicarious liability is essentially when the employer is on the hook for what the employee gets up to and does. And when we think about the Anti-Discrimination Act and the Racial Discrimination Act, essentially it's saying that the employer is always vicariously liable for what the employee does. And we really need to be careful and mindful of that. So what we're going to be doing next is we're going to be working on how since we know that the employer is always going to be liable for these actions, how do we work on that? What do we do next? As an employer, what are we going to do to mitigate that liability so we're not on the hook for all that money? Because we know that employees see employers as entities that have deep pockets, and they're the ones that are going to be sued. So let's see if we can talk about how to mitigate that.
Yeah, so one of the key areas, obviously, is developing a policy. Mm. So policies and, you know, there are some views out there that they're not worth the paper they're written on, and I very much disagree with it. Time and time again, it saves employers. But they need to be effective. And really what we're talking about here is when we first develop a policy is turn our minds to what we're trying to stop. So we've been talking for a bit, but I want to throw it kind of back to you guys. What are some of the things that we might want to, in our policy, try and stop? What are the real dangers that might happen on social media?
In my world, it's defamation, with people commenting, underneath an article of a person, and there's been a court case recently.
Defamation comes up a lot in our space. I've been defamed, in the workplace. There are a lot of defences to defamation, and it is incredibly hard to get up on. When we think of defamation, what we're thinking about is a statement that is either not true or objectively, or to the person who's made it, they don't believe it is also true. Genuine opinion, genuine feeling that it was true at the time. So I think when we think about defamation, what we're thinking about perhaps is workplace bullying, the previous slide. Because if we're posting something that is unfavourable about a different employee, they're essentially bullying that employee or harassing or intimidating that employee. It might amount to defamation, but at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is stop the behaviour from happening. And if we can get a bullying policy in place that prevents them from posting unfavourable messages about fellow employees on social media, That's gonna mitigate a lot of that weird defamation stuff. And
What else? So we've got sort of defamatory or bullying type statements about other employees.
Unfavorable statements.
What else? What can an employee post on their, for example, my to be doing?
I would imagine bringing MJT law in disrepute. So if you're doing something silly with MJT on your server.
Reputational risk is what you're talking about.
Going to a pub, jumping on top of a bar in your MJT shirt, and someone photographs that.
And I've posted on my, you know, my Facebook.
Had a great time last night, came to work drunk.
And it's abundantly clear that I'm representing the company. What else? What about potentially talking about confidential information? Speaking about the clients.
There was a massive case with Virgin years ago where a couple of airline attendants were popping on Facebook, you know, how horrible their clients were on the flights. There was massive problems about that. And that was all linked to the employer and the conduct of the employer. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to get you to stop and think about, when we think about developing a policy, we first of all need to consider what is it that we're trying to prevent or trying to encourage. Yeah, we get a lot of people employers come to us and say, I want you to, really good example, I want a policy on COVID testing.
Yep.
Yeah, but what does that mean? What are we actually trying to achieve here? COVID testing is a thing already. Why do you need a policy on it? So we need to ask more questions to delve down into the situation to see whether or not we need a policy on this testing situation.
And it goes to, I know that we've written here, consider what you might want to stop. But you might also consider not only what we want to stop, but what do we want to encourage? You know, what does our ideal employee look like? And how do we want them to behave on social media? And then it should be said that this goes for kind of all aspects of code of conduct for employees, but really, what do we want to see on their Facebook page?
What are your values as employers? And what are you trying to encourage your employees to also have those values in? So what we're trying to do is we're trying to draw them back to the good and steer them away from the bad.
So we've got there, think about how you might want to stop it. So what kind of practical things can we tell our employees that, you know, will reduce essentially our risk? So with that, we're encouraging them to be diligent, to not really bring the company into disrepute, to avoid at all costs or at all opportunities kind of drawing your personal life into your employment in a way that could be avoided. I know that I've spoken a lot this morning about that sometimes it's unavoidable. But not, for example, posting on behalf of the company. I'm not saying I am from, you know, I'm Christy Santana, I'm from, you know, I'm speaking on behalf of MJT Law and this is what we think. Because that's not necessarily true unless it's really authorised.
I really like the should we test on this point. And when we're talking about social media, we're talking also about people working from home a lot. And we've all seen the posts where someone's sitting there in their shirt and pajama bottoms, or they've got a kid sitting around them and they're taking a Zoom conference call, and we think that's really sweet because they're trying to, you know, do two things at the same time. But is that what an employer actually wants from that person working from home? Does the employer really want that person to be focusing on a child, on a dog, on not being properly dressed while attending a meeting? Is this what we're wanting here? So a policy can also provide direction as to what we are actually looking for here as well. I'm not certain that I would have been comfortable with Chris posting something in his gym jams while he was having a chat to a client about something really serious to do with their employment. And I'm not sure that client would have felt, if they saw that post, that that was something that they would have appreciated while they were paying for that time. So there's lots of things to consider when we think about social media and what's actually the impact here. And we're going to talk a little bit about that in a little while. But you've got a piece of paper there which has a template policy on it. What we've done is we've given you some triggers. So if you are going to be drafting a policy from scratch, which is kind of hard, looking at a blank piece of paper is practically impossible, yeah? How do we get started? So what we've done is we've given you something to kind of get started. I don't know if any of you are looking at drafting policies at the moment, but certainly what we're looking for here is think about what you need to stop or start. Think about how you want to achieve that goal. What are your values? What are you trying to get your employees to do? Is it clear? Have you just drafted a policy that's 20 pages long and no one is going to read it? Yeah, it's sometimes just not great to have. If you've got employees who are not readers, as just generally they're not, then giving them something that's 20 pages long is not going to encourage them to read it. Yeah, so think about how you're going to put this policy in place. I have seen pictorial policies. I think they're really fun. As a lawyer, I can't kind of get my head around how to design those, but they are, you know, really, I think they're really engaging.
Well, it really doesn't need to be a Bible. For example, one of my favourite ones in this sort of point is Commonwealth Bank one. It's one page.
Mm.
It's one page, but it does everything.
Mm.
It's really easy to follow, and really it's really easy to enforce, which is one of the key areas. Mm. It doesn't need to be a Bible. It doesn't need to be 20 pages with 3 pages of everything that you can't do, because you can also point to the things that you want you to do, and anything that we don't want you to, anything that we, it's outside of what we want to do, isn't allowed.
So the last thing you need to consider when it comes to policies is there a discriminatory element to it? It's a real trap. We want to write something, we want it to stop something, but are we being discriminatory at the same time? We might be, again, talking about something that is for the safety of others. For a really long time, airline attendants had a height restriction, couldn't be below a certain height. And that was really discriminatory to some cultures who were shorter than others. And they said, and the concept behind this height restriction for years and years was because they had to get things up and down from heights. And being a particular height, being under a particular height meant it was dangerous. So, and that sounds fine, except it's discriminatory. So we need to look at other ways we can encourage and write these policies that doesn't discriminate. And the trap that one falls into is this indirect discrimination. It's not directly saying something about a particular attribute. It's kind of giving that impression by the way it's been drafted. So that's kind of the last trap, I think, employers might fall into if they're drafting their own policies.
Sure. So is the policy useful? Does it actually work? I want to talk about a case that we've kind of called the urine test, or the drug and alcohol test. It's a very, very recent, it was about 2 months ago. So what it involved was a employer who sold building supplies, timber, and employees sometimes attended work sites, but it was fairly rare. They were mostly salespeople. And they had a zero tolerance, all-in type policy for drug and alcohol. So what that really means is, doesn't matter whether you are attending the site all the time or if you are the receptionist in the office, there is to be no alcohol or drugs in your system at any time.
Or poppy seed cake.
Or poppy seed cake.
Has to be picked up by the testing facility itself.
So with this policy, they would, when a employee began, they would sit them down, and amongst other policies as well, they would do a PowerPoint presentation and made sure that they really understood what it meant in the policies and what they really expected. They also did this as a matter of routine for even the existing employees. I believe they did it every sort of 3 months. And not only that, but they also enforced the policy with, I think, significant rigor. In fact, in one of their offices, they fired just over 90% of their workforce.
Overnight.
Overnight, 13 employees who had all tested positive. So really what we're seeing there is, beyond doubt, if you are testing
aggressive implementation of a zero tolerance policy.
And it's really important to note, of the, for example, 13 employees that they had fired overnight, I'm sure there's some that they liked. There were some that were really high performers, but they were nevertheless breaching the policy and they were disciplined for it. So one day, this particular employee, they come to work and they're doing testing that day, and they were doing testing through a third party, which is a really good idea because obviously their building suppliers. They don't know how to conduct drug and alcohol testing, as you can probably imagine. And funnily enough, she initially poured just water into the cup, which was naturally picked up fairly quickly. She then refused to provide a proper sample.
This was a urine test sample?
Yep, so she refused on the basis that she had a urinary tract infection and requested that she get a swab test instead. Now, the employee, it came out in the case that she knew that swab tests weren't as accurate as urine tests were, and also covered a shorter period of time than urine tests did. Nevertheless, she was stood down and given time to attend and give a urine sample. So she was not to come to work until she was cleared.
So she refused to take the urine test, and she said, I've got a urine tract infection. And they said, and the employer said, okay, that's fine. We'll stand you down until you can take your urine test. And they gave her a fair amount of time.
They gave her about 9 days, actually, which I suppose in my view, although that's completely out of the abundance of caution, I'm not sure they needed to do so.
Probably not.
But it's they wise did it anyway. Nonetheless.
During that time, her urine tract infection had healed up. And
So she continued and continued to refuse, and subsequently she was fired. And she brought a unfair dismissal claim on the basis that she ought to have been given the chance to provide that swab test, that the policy was unreasonable given that she was a office worker. She didn't feel as though she posed a risk or anything like that. And that the urine test was nevertheless invasive, if you want to call it that.
Mm.
She was unsuccessful. And what the commission found was the policy was well written in a way that it didn't give the particular employee the ability to elect the type of testing. So it was really in the discretion of the employer as to the method. But it also spoke to really whether the policy was reasonable and lawful.
Yeah, they came up with this concept, didn't they? They said, well, you've drafted a policy. We don't care what's in it necessarily, as long as there's no discrimination.
Mm.
There was no argument that the policy was lawful. So it can be applied. So, and it was applied vigorously.
Vigorously. And when we're thinking about an all-in type of policy, and this goes back to social media policies, because generally they are pretty all-in. It applies to everyone, irrespective of your job, role, seniority. Mm. What they said was there's really nothing unreasonable about an all-in type of policy, specifically in this case for drug and alcohol, because office-based staff also have workplace health and safety risks. They could pour hot water when they're making a tea onto their hand and burn themselves, which is equally as dangerous for them as what could happen on site. And when we're thinking about social media, the damage that you can do to a company can be equal for a senior employee as it is for a junior. Really depends on what the conduct they're doing, what are they posting, and how really visible is it.
Yeah.
But it's really one where you can imply a pretty all-in-all type of policy.
The key takeaway here is we know that discrimination, bullying, harassment, we know there's all these things that can happen when it comes to social media. And we know that employers are vicariously liable for the conduct of their employees. So we also know that the way that employers can mitigate that responsibility is to implement a policy, is to enforce the policy, to revisit that policy, to make sure that they are applying that policy with the same fairness as they would on everyone. A policy is only as good as the implementation and the way it's been dealt with. If you've got friends in the workplace and you don't apply that policy to those people and you're applying a policy to someone else, then you're going to have problems. So what we're talking about here is setting up the policy for success and then driving that policy for success.
And we see it all the time.
All the
where,
time.
And I'll bring it back to social media policies, where a particular employee typically a junior employee, might post something which we can all agree they shouldn't have and probably breaches the policy, but they turn around and say, well, what about my boss? I'm Facebook friends with my boss and I know that he posts all sorts of things that are in breach of the policy, but they were never disciplined for it. And that will inevitably lead the employer to issues.
Yeah, it's going to water down your ability to mitigate your loss in these areas. Talking about implementation, the next slide is about when conduct happens in the workplace. And we're specifically talking about out-of-hours conduct. So we've been talking about social media and how that can happen at all hours of the day. And we've got a really mad case about a Telstra employee who was out in a regional zone. He got into a fight at a bar and then later on had an altercation with a work colleague.
Yeah, so the both of them were travelling interstate. This particular employee, they both went to a nightclub that night, and this particular employee was seen getting into a bit of an altercation with some other people at the pub, and one of the other employees that he was with grabbed him away, and they both went to the hotel room they were staying at.
So the language here is, I found him at the bar having an argument with a person we both knew. I tried to appease him, and he told me to fuck off, and the ladies all saw this. Oh dear. I went back to my chair and he followed me. He ripped his shirt off and growled at me. I thought he wanted to fight me. This upset me. I told Carl that he didn't need to fight with these fellows, and I told him that I would have words with him later, and then wanted to avoid a scene at the place. Now, back at the room, Carl struck me on the chest with a piece of glass. I managed to get free and grabbed the girl he came with and went downstairs and called an ambulance and got 12 stitches. So we're talking about conduct that happened well after work had finished for the day. They're out in a regional town getting up to what appears to be an awful lot of mischief. Now, the employer found out about this. The person in the bar knew that they were Telstra employees. So
What do we think? So we have a situation where two employees who are on a work trip, but they are on a night out, and they've done some pretty abhorrent things. They've gotten into fights at a pub, which other people were at. They've gone back into the hotel room where they were both staying at. They've had another altercation. One of them has been stabbed.
Yep.
What do we think we would do? Now, this is the employee who was stabbed but was also the one who was getting in the altercation at the pub.
So when we think about, does conduct happen in the workplace, is this happening in the workplace?
What do we think? Did you say work trip though?
It is a work trip.
So what would you think? Enough for hours, isn't it? If you're sent off on a 3-day work trip, even though aren't you still representing the company?
Well, it's a good question. What do you think?
Yeah.
Okay.
I would say yes. Still considered part of the workplace.
Certainly.
Especially if they're paying for your hotel.
You'd be pretty upset.
Yeah, getting up and stabbing someone's probably not going to work well for you.
Yeah, I'd say yes.
Well, what do we think?
Do we agree with that?
What do we do agree?
It's happening in the workplace. It's being paid for by the work. Yeah. Okay.
Well, when we think about it, really we're talking about, are you representing the company? But what does that really mean?
So the courts concluded that the employer's behaviour outside work hours will only have an impact on their employment to the extent that it is in breach of an express or implied term of the contract of employment. So when we're thinking about work hours, what do you guys think? Are you working when you're asleep on a work function? Are you working when you're having dinner 4 hours after work had finished?
So hours of work, yeah.
Yeah. Are you on call? Is that the question, perhaps?
Yeah.
Are you on the job when you're on an aeroplane, asleep? These are questions we need to ask ourselves on these things. If conduct, objectively considered, is likely to cause serious damage to the relationship between the employer and the employee, then a breach of implied obligation may arise. So now we're moving towards this fuzzy area of, is there the objective bystander, what's happening here? It says here, it's unclear that in certain circumstances an employee's employment may be validly terminated because of out-of-hours conduct, but each circumstance is limited. So, and we've got this up here, you know, it needs to be viewed objectively and so on and so forth. This is a fascinating case, because I think we can all say that if you're out in a small town as a Telstra employee having a fight and then ended up in stitches and one of them ended up in jail, is this going to affect Telstra? Is it?
In a very small way.
In a small way? How? The publican did, but nobody else. Where are we going? It's really hard, isn't it, when we're thinking about out-of-hours conduct.
Yeah, and it just needs one person to hit the country grapevine and go, guess what I saw at the pub tonight?
You're absolutely right. It's horrifying, right? It's a really scary situation.
But that case is fairly old, and
it is very old.
Is, the leading case on this, and that's why we bring it up.
Yeah.
But if we think about if this happened in modern times, so let's add a bit of a twist to it, and say.
This is your scenario.
Yeah, they were.
It was videoed.
They were videoed and
it's
tagged.
On Facebook. It's on Twitter. You can do videos.
It goes viral. It's abundantly clear. You know, it doesn't take much for viral.
Two Telstra employees
to figure out who's on it. It potentially goes on to a news source.
Yeah.
Then we're starting to talk about out within office hours.
Yeah, in this case, in 1998, it wasn't related to work because only the publican knew. He says, I do not think that there is a reasonable basis for concluding that the conduct had damaged the employee's interests. The evidence is of any publicity as a result is scant. And the court listing in respect to the criminal charges appeared in a local paper, but not suggested to be identifiable as a Telstra employee. And that's your key here when we're thinking about, is it happening? Is out-of-hours conduct going to be connected to your work environment? And yes, you're right. You're at a work, say you're at one of these work functions where you've taken over the entire hotel. And you're sitting there having a massive fight. You get your glass, you smash it, you start stabbing someone. They're going to know where you're from. You know? And everybody around you's got a video now. You know, they've got cameras, they've got videos. It's up immediately. You can't stop it from happening. You can see in 2000, in 2021, we've got a real problem here. But when we're thinking about it, we need to think about it from an employer's situation. Is it affecting the business? Can you be linked to it? Are there going to be problems with reputational risk? And the Fair Work Act says that if you do conduct that affects the reputation of your employer, then you can be discharged, be terminated for serious misconduct. So it's a real trap. These things are very, very difficult to manage.
And if we kind of turn to social media, I'll give you two examples of one where I think would be caught and one which wouldn't. You've got and I'm going to use myself as another example, and we know that it's abundantly clear where I work if you look on my profile. And I post something, let's just make it extreme, and it's something extremely racist on there. Quite clearly, you can put it to the reputation of MJT Law and my employer. I think that would be caught. But if we turn to, I don't know how many of us have Reddit, for example. Reddit is a sort of blogging type platform. A lot of the times people have anonymous accounts. And I post something which is the exact same. It's quite racist, but it's on a completely anonymous site. I don't make any reference to where I work on any of my profile. I don't even really make anything that you could read through the lines to figure out where I worked. I don't think that would be caught.
No, we've got to look at the subjective. We're going to play a video soon that's an awful lot of fun on this point. Yes?
So what about if you be racist, like,
yep,
against your own culture, mm-hmm, but, you know, okay, as a joke. So, for example, I'm half black. What if I'm making a joke about my own...
Yeah, using the word half-caste, like, that sort of thing.
mean, yep. I don't do this.
It's really, it's actually really hard. We talked about this really early on with discrimination. Because you don't feel you're being discriminating doesn't mean it's not discriminating.
Okay.
Yeah.
Even if it's my own culture.
Even if you're doing it because you think it's funny, someone might find that offensive, and they might find it's discriminating. Yeah. So it's a real trap to fall into. In a perfect world, I would say, stay well clear of social media if you can, and if you do put social media on, put pictures of your pets. I've got on my social media page 100,000 photos of my husband and I doing this in different circumstances. Yep, just selfies. We're here, you know, that sort of thing. I never talk about work. I never talk about anything. It's just photos. And now there's a lot of photos of my four pets.
So even if it's like satire or something like that, that's well, considered...
Lawyers tend to be overly cautious on these things.
Yeah.
I sit in a... And I'm in a...
Well, I'm, use Facebook.
And I'm a business owner as well, so yeah. I, you know, and things that I do affect how people see me as a lawyer as well. So my personal life and my work life are very separate. And it's a lot easier for me because as a lawyer, I'm not asked to give my personal opinion about absolutely anything. No one cares. What they care about is my legal opinion. And that's all I can give. So it's actually really easy for me to remain completely separate as a individual having an opinion about something, but what is the legal proposition here? What is the legal opinion? So it's actually super simple for me, but it's much harder for others.
Okay.
Yes.
So one of the hats I wear is with a not-for-profit.
Is it what, sorry?
One of the hats I wear is with a not-for-profit. And it involves advocacy.
Yep.
And of course we are all volunteers, whether we're on a committee or whether we're just a general member. One of the issues that we're potentially concerned about comes up every year on Equal Pay Day. And the commentary that can come about Equal Pay Day from others posting on one of our public pages. So we'll throw something up about 86.4% and this much, and what would you do with an extra $13,000 over your lifetime? And if that goes onto a public post, then the commentary that comes with that, and it comes back to that slightly off of this, but the obligations to manage those comments.
You would manage those comments. My advice to you is to manage those comments and remove comments that are highly offensive. That would be my recommendation. I am not a defamation solicitor.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not a defamation solicitor, and I work purely in the employment environment. But I would see a lot of red flags with that, personally. But I'm not sure by nature, because that's probably not true. But certainly as a profession, I'm very cautious, and I'm not just risk aware, but I would be risk averse. But yeah, I would manage those posts. I would also. And certainly I'm moving into an area which perhaps is not quite my area of expertise, but there must be some type of way that you can add to your Facebook page that the views of the people who are posting are not necessarily the views of your organisation, and I would look into seeing how you could promote that concept as well.
There's a precedent to set that doesn't come out.
But there's no freedom of speech in employment. Why would there be?
Oh, God, I'm just throwing that.
So we've been talking about how to kind of...
Sorry, did you have a question?
Oh, no, it's just, I mean, I've said I don't have a Facebook account, but I mean, I do, but I don't usually use it. But I've got a Facebook group called Time Before, and they post up historical photos of people in grass skirts and someone topless, but Facebook says that we can't post them up, so they've got to be covered. So
yeah.
I think Facebook also would...
There's a lot of moderation for Facebook.
Yeah.
But if you lie, you've got my card there, I can send you off to someone who will be able to provide you with better advice than me on this point. Yeah, I work in a rather narrow space, so.
So we've been talking a lot about how to firstly develop a policy that'll work, essentially protecting against social misuse of social media. But also what we need to do is what happens when something goes wrong?
Yeah.
So we've got the policy, it's all great. But
we're implementing it, we've been enforcing it, and now something horrible's happened.
Someone's posted something that's abhorrent.
There's been complaints,
and it's on your desk. So what do we do?
We investigate, and I can't. And I put it up there three times because I cannot express enough how a good investigation will save your business from problems next. Yeah, if you investigate in a way that provides procedural fairness in an independent way, then you are going to be far more protected from any claims in relation to this matter than you could be if you just did a half-assed job at it. Yeah. And we're not, and some of the small business problems that we see when it comes to investigation is you're complaining about the owner. And that's me, and I want to investigate. Well, I can't, because that's about me, yeah? And I now need to find somebody else who's going to do that. And independent investigations is the way to go forward on these points. But that's expensive. So if there's other ways that you can do it, then absolutely explore them. But it needs to be independent. It needs to be, without that kind of...
Free of kind of duress as well.
Yeah.
We often hear about someone was called in to give their side of the story, and it doesn't need to be in a really formal way, it's just really a conversation with their manager. But they didn't really have the relationship with their manager where they could be frank and honest about something that quite often could be a bit embarrassing for them. And maybe their manager doesn't like them.
Mm.
And that's quite frequent.
Yeah.
So they were just completely biased against them.
Yeah, so we're talking about documentation, we're talking about moving it forward in a way that makes sense. And just talking on that point of investigation, I'm going to go back to that case where our chap, Glenn, is the Organisational Effectiveness and Change Manager. I love this title. I actually think this title's amazing. It's all capitalised too, it's brilliant, all names. And he said, since starting here, I've noticed that there's a lot of distrust. And he says, a number of employees have commented that they feel they've been set up when they're questioned about an allegation regarding conduct at work. Employees at the terminal often feel inclined to accept rumours and innuendo as fact when they consider they heard it from a reliable source, and often resist having a fact-based discussion about the evidence of what's occurred. Employees are often refer to rumours but are unwilling or unable to identify those persons involved. There can be a tendency for employees to make complaints about the daily interactions of other employees that they are dissatisfied with. Some employees who are informed they've been and identified as being involved in allegations then make counterclaims involving other employees, and there have been incidences of graffiti and vandalism which apparently are directed at particular employees. So like I said when we brought this case up in the early days, this is about a real failure to properly investigate. We've got this in this is all the things we don't want to see. We don't want to see counterclaims that are just willy-nilly because they're angry that they've been investigated themselves. We don't want to see people who are secretly recording conversations because there's such a low level of trust. We don't want to see people feeling they've been set up when they are being questioned, because that won't make an honest and open investigation process. So this would have had to been going on for more than, what would be considered a reasonable amount of time for this sort of behaviours to be going on, for employees to be feeling like this. So when we're talking about applying a policy and then investigating it, we're talking about not just sitting on it. Get it done. If you've got a counterclaim, deal with the thing in front of you first, then deal with the counterclaim. And we hear this all the time. Somebody puts a bullying claim into a manager, and that manager automatically says, well, that person's underperforming, or that person is doing X, or I caught that person drinking the other day. I don't want to talk about it right now, but this is why they're complaining about me. Yeah? And you've got to bite your elephant off one bite at a time, yeah? Deal with the complaint first, then deal with the next complaint. See how it flows out. So you have a question?
So what if, going back to your not-for-profit
yeah.
example, and you're an executive, and then there is the management as well, but no one wants to do anything. But if you are an executive, you actually take steps to say, look, I actually don't think it's appropriate, or what you're doing is blah, 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 or so on, so on. Is that, are you covering yourself then?
You're talking about from a management perspective, and who's on the hook.
If you're on the executive. And
It is a very difficult space to remove yourself from being on the hook for inappropriate behaviours for the not-for-profit when you're a board member. You would have to have some very robust documentation to remove yourself from the situation, and I would go as far as resigning if you felt that it wasn't going to work. Because liability in the space of not-for-profits is surprisingly considerable. And insurances don't necessarily cover for behaviours that are negligent. So, it's a bit of an interesting space. It's a little bit out of my range. I work in employment, and what we're talking about is the broad sense, the commercial aspect of the not-for-profit business and how the veil is placed in front of the directors, which is a little bit out of my area of expertise. But like this lady here, I can certainly send you to someone who can provide you more information on that, if you're interested.
But so if we sort of turn it back to this disaster case, I'm really of the view that if they had of kind of taken a backward step and just got an external investigator, the whole issue would have been basically put to bed. Because one, the external investigators they're good at their jobs. They do it day in, day out. They will make sure that everyone is given a fair chance to speak. They're also really independent. No one involved actually knows these people. They'll probably never ever come in contact with them ever again. They won't, for example, relay unnecessary information to managers, which allows for kind of open conversation. But it also protects against what we call discrimination general protections claims. So these are, you know, we hear it all the time, well, the reason they are investigating me is because of X, and for a discriminatory reason. Because I complained about X 6 months ago. The good thing with an external investigator is they don't know these things. They don't know that there was a big blue 6 months ago, or that, you know, this person had a particular issue with that employee. They just don't know. They only do the thing that's directly in front of them.
So you implement a policy that makes sense to deal with the thing that you're trying to solve, and today we're talking about social media. You teach your employees or the people in your organisation what that policy means. You implement it with reckless abandonment.
Yes.
Crazy, your own case. And you investigate it properly, and you get on with it. We have a rather interesting video.
Yes.
And Phoebe, I think you're going to switch it on.
Es ist dem Feind gelungen, die Front in breiter Formation zu durchbrechen. Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow, und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer,
Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodel, Krebs und Burgdorf. Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff Steiners war ein Befehl! Wer sind Sie?
Das hier ist Magen! Sie mein Befehl zu Ihren Seiten! So weit ist das also gekommen. Das Militär hat mich verlogen! Jeder hat mich verlogen, sogar die SS! Die gesamte Generalität ist nichts weiter als ein Haufen niederträchtiger, treuloser Feiglinge!
Mein Führer, ich kann nicht zulassen, dass die Soldaten, die für Sie verbringen...
Ist das Feiglinge! Verräter, Versager!
Mein Führer, was Sie da sagen, ist ungeheuerlich!
Die Generalität ist das Geschmeiß des deutschen Volkes! Sie ist ohne Ehre! Sie nennen sich Generale, weil Sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält!
Jahrelang hat das Militär meine Aktionen nur behindert. Es hat mich jeden nur als
Widerstand in den Weg gelegt. Ich hätte gut daran getan, von Jahren alle höheren Offiziere registrieren zu lassen, wie Stalin. Ich war nie auf einer Akademie. Und doch habe ich allein auf mich gestellt. Ganz Europa erobert. Verräter. Von allem Anfang an bin ich so verraten und betrogen worden. Es wurde ein ungeheurer Verrat geübt am deutschen Volke. Aber alle diese Verräter werden bezahlen. Mit ihrem eigenen Blut werden sie bezahlen. Sie werden es saufen in ihrem eigenen Blut.
Bitte, Gerda, jetzt beruhig dich doch.
Meine Befehle sind in den Wind gesprochen. Es ist unmöglich, unter diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen Berlin verlasse, irren Sie sich gewaltig. Eher jage ich mir eine Kugel durch den Kopf. Tun Sie, was Sie wollen.
So this was because this happened a little while ago. BP was in enterprise agreement bargaining with the employees. And it was challenging at the time. Now, one of the employees, one of the employees' wives created this and posted it on their personal social media network. What do we think of that? It's pretty funny.
Bearing in mind, this is an employee who's on the other side of the negotiating.
Yes.
And this video is clearly about the negotiating team.
He's a worker.
From, I suppose, head office.
Mm. But what do we think?
Yeah.
Social media? Do we think it's funny?
What would we do with this? We've come to find out about it.
Yep, you're the employer. What do we do?
Are we dismissing him? Are we letting it fly?
Are we going to have
a stern conversation with him? What do we think?
Do we just think it's funny and move on? What's happening here?
The Nazi thing is a little bit...
iffy? Yeah, doesn't sit right, perhaps?
Not really.
It is funny, though. That's the problem. Also, this is a clip, and I didn't know this at the time. This is a clip that's been used a million times. So I don't know if you guys have seen it in other social media, but it's been used over and over and over again.
There's various different ones. I've seen one of the, at the time, the Brisbane Broncos weren't doing very well, and they used that clip about what was going on behind the scenes and, you know, all the disasters that were happening with the team.
Yeah.
So it was used pretty much across the board.
What do we think? How are you going to treat this employee?
Just because it's commonly used, though.
Ooh, good point.
Good point.
How do we feel about this, guys? You don't want to put your hand up and say it's funny? Look, I think it's funny, personally. Court, in the first instance, said quite strong terms. The Deputy President gave consideration to whether a reasonable person would consider the video to be offensive or inappropriate. And the Deputy President said, I do not accept by labelling something as a parody is a get out of jail free card. It necessarily means it is not offensive. So this is what you're saying here. A racist joke is by name humour, but is not like, but is likely to offend a person of nationality at which it is aimed. So that's what the court of the first instance said. So our first impression, what happened was the guy got fired. There was an investigation, he was told he was was alleged that having shared and distributed material which was highly offensive and inappropriate, utilised another employee's BP login to share the material, were involved in creating the material and is aware that others were involved in creating material and with a potential cover-up. He explained he had not intended to offend anyone. He was just intended to boost, as a humorous post, to boost employee morale. And it was posted on a private Facebook page and not intended to be viewed by anybody else. And he removed it. Didn't work. He was terminated. He then appealed. What do you think the appeal court said about this? What do we think? Do you think the appeal court thought that Deputy President was right? Offensive material is offensive material and that's all we have to say about it? Or do you think they had something more to say about this?
I think they might have had something to say about it.
Yeah, they did have something more to say about it. The appeal commission said, we do not accept that it is reasonably open for the video to be characterised in a way it was by the Deputy President. Even considered in isolation, the mimetic context, it is apparent that the video does not liken BP management to Hitler or Nazis in the sense of stating or suggesting that their conduct or behaviour was in some sense comparable to their inhumanity or criminality. What it does do is to compare, for satirical purposes, the position BP had reached in the enterprise bargaining process to the situation Hitler was facing in the Nazi regime in 1945. The position becomes even clearer when one considers the context of the development and use of the downfall clip into the meme. The clip has been used thousands of times over a period of more than a decade for the purpose of creating an entirely imaginative way, satirical depiction of contemporary situations, and has had the result of culturally disassociating it from the import of the historical events portrayed in the film. There is no doubt that the clip would be understood by a reasonable viewer as satirising BP's conduct during the enterprise agreement bargaining process, and that by itself did not make it offensive or inappropriate.
So basically,
hard.
It was a joke.
It was a joke, and we should take ourselves a lot less seriously.
And after everything we've said today, sometimes you need to take a common sense approach and see it for what it is.
Yeah.
One of the problems they had with this case was the key, I suppose, person who was aggrieved by this video was the head of the negotiating team. And he was of the view that he was Hitler in this particular video.
Yeah. He inserted himself as Hitler.
He had inserted himself, but that was the thing, though. He had done so with his own mind, not because of the video itself.
So I guess what we're saying at the end of this is, yes, there are lots and lots of things you can do to get it right. There are absolutely lots and lots, but it is difficult. And this case is a really good example of, we liked it, it's just kind of wrong, and it shouldn't be done in the workplace. But yet, the full court of appeal, the full bench of the appeal commission, said, dudes, just relax.
Whereas if they'd taken him for the IT breach, they'd have probably been
successful.
Maybe.
Maybe. That wasn't on the table at the time. But yes, it's a fascinating...
Take a common kind of
Yeah, what I like to say is, user, should we approach? Should we be doing this?
Mm.
What are we thinking about here? Is it damaging our reputation? Really, what is happening here? When we're thinking about it as an employer, what are we thinking about in terms of the damage to the reputation? What's the big picture here? What breach of policy has actually been made? Is this something that we need to deal with? Look, I think I probably would have sought to discipline this employee myself. I think I would have probably come up a crop like BP Refinery did. I may not have terminated, I don't know, but I definitely would have asked very stern questions about the length of that. It was online.
Mm.
And I probably would have... Well,
we get this question all the time where there's been a breach of the policy and do we need to terminate? You know, kind of our head goes straight to it. And really the answer is no. You need to really consider what is going on at the time. And sometimes it doesn't need to be a termination in order to be really implementing a policy. It can be as much as a really stern conversation with this gentleman, saying firstly, remove the post.
Mm.
You may need to have some cooperative conversations with the people involved, and just reminding everyone that the policy exists. This is a breach of the policy.
And what's at the time, what they were trying to achieve was an agreement between two parties. If you're in conflict with those parties, it's going to be harder to get that agreement. So we need to go back to basics and say, what is the company trying to achieve here as well? I've been part of bargaining processes for energy resource companies myself, and this is the sort of thing that happens, you know, in these matters. It becomes them and us. It becomes, you know, there's who's hiding what information, that sort of thing. So this was, when I watch this, I don't think, this is a really unusual situation in this environment. It's not, it's absolutely not. Well, that's the end of our presentation. Hopefully you've taken something away from this. What we wanted to achieve by this is to, first of all, teach you what some of the traps and holes are in terms of social media and dealing with it as an employer in the workplace, and how to resolve those issues. And from this last clip, how to really stop and think, put an objective set of trousers on and stop and think about what it looks like, about damaging the reputation and so on. Do I have any questions?
Thank you. No, it's our pleasure. Do we have any questions?
Well, thank you very much for watching. And this is my first session, so maybe I'll come back.
Maybe.